When kids come into our systems, our recreational systems, et cetera, we're not social service agencies. It's not our responsibility to try to figure out what has happened to you in your life. However, almost always you're going to have some child or children who will come to your system who have been victims in some way. And we as youth serving organization members will never recognize that if we aren't educated about what may have happened to these children. That's why we're here today, to help you understand some of the things that happen to children and why it is a common phenomenon and that they often don't tell. So let me just say a little bit about intrafamilial prostitution. This is when a parent or a family member sells a child for sex, not necessarily for money. Many times what is happening is that that child is being made available to somebody who might be providing food, clothing, and shelter to that family. So in the past, when we talked to child protective services folks, and the child would say, yes, I did tell mommy that her boyfriend was touching me, but she said it wasn't true. In the past, those of us who work in this area would say, okay, you know, we have our reports. And I've written this many times. The custodial parent is in denial and has not provided appropriate support for the child. That's what my report would typically say. However, until Dr. Estes' research, we never even thought, could this parent actually not be in denial? Could this parent know quite well that her boyfriend is sexually abusing her children and she is choosing to allow that to happen because that boyfriend is paying all the bills? We just hadn't thought about that, but that is definitely possible. And it requires that we dig a lot deeper now when we have children that tell us that they have been that rare child who has made a disclosure and a family member who has said, no, it's not true, be quiet, go on about your business. That form of denial. Who was it who mentioned denial on my row back there? Was it you who mentioned? Right, and so that's why denial may not be denial. Denial may in fact be intrafamilial prostitution of that child. The sexual acts are the same as we see with other things. The child is a commodity. The child is a commodity in that household. And the payment may be money, but it may also want to be food, clothing, and shelter, or influence or network with others who have a preferential interest in children. And there may be a technology facilitating crime in this situation. I love this particular PSA poster. This is from the Cyber Tip Line in Manitoba, Canada. And this is one of the things that they have to help parents understand the issues of webcams and who is really talking to your child and who's really looking at your child. And that's what we see in cyber enticing cases. This is a form of abuse that entails the act of grooming a child. In the online world, for an ultimate sexual encounter, usually with an adult in the offline world. And the enticement usually begins in the online world through chat, through webcam interactions. Today it would be through Skype or some other type of, because all of us, almost all laptops now, you know, have their own built-in webcams. So therefore it's really easy for someone to talk to a child and look at them at the same time and the child see who they're talking to. Via email or instant messages are the most common method in which individuals will communicate with kids who are talking to them online because they can just break right in. Social networking site blogs is another new way in which kids are being groomed in the online world. And most recently, we've begun to see kids who are being groomed through video games. How does that happen? Okay, who in here understands massively multiplayer online role-playing games, video games? I know somebody in here, many people, all right? But I have to ask somebody inside the room because I know that it's been a quiet side over here. Sorry. Who over here knows how to play Call of Duty or has an Xbox? You have an Xbox, or understand it, right? Many people do not necessarily use. Can you explain to everybody else how you can talk to people and play a game like that?
Yeah, I mean, there's like a headset.
That's right. And the people you're talking to on the video game are avatars. So they have an identity, but it's an avatar identity, right? And you have your own avatar identity. And so you can play in, and so those are called MMORPGs, massively multiplayer online role-playing games. And so MMO players
many times play hours at a time because the game never ends. And this is one of the challenges as a pediatrician when I'm talking to parents about their children and their video gaming behaviors. There's a lot of new research about that. I have to tell you, it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. But when I talk to parents about their video game behaviors, I try to help parents understand that if you have a video game that's on a DVD, that's a better type of video game for a youth as compared to online. And here's why. On a DVD, the child is playing against the game, you know, and they get to level 5 or they get to level 6, etc., and they can either pause it or stop it, and there it is, and then they can go to bed. Because when they come back, you know, they can go back to where they were. And that allows the child to feel, okay, I'm in control of this game. However, the draw of the online world is that when you stop playing, the game continues. And this is what makes it hard for kids and adults to give it up. Because they, in their mind, you know, it's still going on and I just really need to be there. Well, what we have seen now in video games is that kids who are talking to a total stranger who now has the image of an avatar online, gets online and says, hey, great white knight of the Far East, are you out there? Yes, I am. I've been waiting for you. You know, can we meet in the land of forever and ever gone? Yes, yes, I'm on my stallion. I'm on my way right now. Oh, here's somebody. He's going to try to stop me. I have to fight him. I have to do this. You know, and so they get through all the challenges to meet their friend, the great white knight of the Far East, who's over here. And they're talking to them in the process, and the person is talking back to them. It's no longer just an avatar on a game. Now it's verbalization. And this is where we have now begun to see offenders who will say, I'm so glad that you made it here to the Far East. Wow, I really want to meet you in the real world. You are the most important, you're the smartest person I ever met. How old are you? You're probably 13? Well, you know, I'm just about maybe 26, but age is just a number, and the whole grooming process begins. And it begins with the image of an avatar, not even a real person in front of that child, but they hear that child talking to them every day when they get back online, and then they play until 11 or 12 o'clock at night. So we've been beginning to see more and more cases of cyber enticement through video games of kids. When you think about prevention from the perspective of youth-serving organizations, this is a very good area to eventually think about. What can we do? We know that these kids are typically outside playing sports and things during the day. They're in their cabins in the early evenings, etc. We can have a discussion about this. We can even have a mock-up example while they're in their cabins in the evening talking about whatever it is that we want them to talk about how you don't know who the person you're playing that game with really is. That's a very good means of prevention by education of children, because although we are very good about educating children, don't talk to strangers in chat rooms, if somebody comes online and sends you an instant message, that's a stranger, but we have not even begun that dialogue with respect to video games. And yet, how many kids do you think play video games? And the gaming, we used to think that the safety net was the kind of gaming system that we had. If we had a Nintendo DS, well, you know, that doesn't lend in those really hardcore games. You don't have to worry about sexual content. My children are going to be safe because it's a Nintendo DS kind of system. Or we have a Wii. It's all exercise. It's all playing. It's bowling. It's skiing downhill. My children are going to be just fine. We just, the FBI just recently had a case of a child moved through a game on the Wii by a cyber enticer as well. So it's the safety no longer is a gaming system. The safety is in not letting children stay on games for prolonged periods of time, and to remind them that the people they're playing with on these games are still strangers. They don't see them as strangers because it's the great white knight from the Far East that they've been looking for since they've come online. Do you understand? Does that make sense? Okay. So I'm not only am I talking about rape, crime, and pillage, but I'm also talking about normal social behavior of children today. How can we help to keep them safe through their and our own social behavior? Hopefully that makes sense. A significant percentage of people who do contact children and groom them contact them outside of the internet. They send them mail in 77% of cases. They also send these children mail, text messages, cell phone calls, they often send them cell phones as a gift. So that here's your child who's 12 years old, and they have a friend who's been their friend now for about maybe 3 months. This friend talks to them online and is 14. Your child is 12. And they just say, well, you know, you're just so wonderful, you're so perfect. And this friend says, I'm going to send you a gift, and it's going to come in the mail for you. And they get it, and it's a cell phone. And the friend says, you know, I don't think your parents would be so cool with us talking. So make sure you hide this cell phone inside one of your shoes in the closet. And you can only call me at night. And by the way, I'm really not 14, I'm really 21. But, you know, we've been talking to each other for 3 months, so... It'll be okay, and then that way we can still be best friends. I am truly not making up this kind of conversation because this has been studied very much in depth in our country as to how these things occur. Other tangible gifts of money, often from online shipping businesses like Amazon.com, which has a program, it has a feature of Amazon that I can go to Amazon and meet somebody. I have somebody, and I'd like to have I wish I could have a whatever, and I can tell somebody that I'd like for them to give it to me, and they can order it and pay for it, and it'll be delivered to me without them ever knowing my address or where I am. So a child will feel safe from these online businesses. So this form of abuse entails the other thing for us to know is that cybersexing is a frequent component of communication. Okay, so who knows what cybersexing is? It's okay. Confession is good for the soul, but bad for the reputation. Who knows what cybersexing is? You remember the book, The Joy of Sex? Remember that? That's an old book. So now, you know, there is a book. You knew there was another one written, and it's called The Joy of Cybersex. So who knows what cybersex is? It's okay. No one will think oddly of you. How about this back row? Y'all know what cybersexing is?
Oh, I'm guessing it's just when you're online and you're performing sexual acts for other people not to see.
Close, very close. That's correct. Cybersexing started in chat rooms without the use of webcams. And it usually was talking. But it wasn't talking, it was typing. So cybersexing gave new meanings to letters. For example, letter M, just the letter M. In cybersex chat, M across the page, M, all right, is a form of cybersex. And what does that mean? It means I'm moaning because you're so sexy to me, you're just making me moan, oh my gosh. That's what the letter M is. You all need to get out more, I can tell. I know it's elementary, I'm trying to break it down. But cybersexing is sexual talk. Sexual chat, no pictures, no webcam, it's just talk. And so when you have somebody who's sending instant messages to a youth online, they can simply say, I've been thinking about you all day. And that's a very sexual type of communication. It's not like, I've been thinking about you all day because I just, you know, got out of the gap and I thought I saw something that you would look really cool in. It's not the same. Do you see the difference? I've been thinking about you all day. That's cybersexing. And it's just yet another component of what happens in this situation. Before I give us a break, let me just finish these types of child sexual exploitation. This is a prevention poster that I had to take a picture of because I thought it was so great. In the Philippines, I was speaking at a conference in the Philippines. It says, turn a child sex tourist into an ex-tourist. Child sex tourists don't turn away, turn in. Now, this sounds like it would have nothing to do with youth or women. Unless you have a youth serving organization that has international relations with other kids that come to the United States for the summer, and they come to a camping experience for the summer, and have their own chaperones. Think about that, because if organizations have those kinds of connections, and they have an individual who has a preferential interest in children, who then comes as an international person to a camp as a chaperone, is there a potential risk there? Do you think that people who have a preferential interest in children hang out in youth-serving organizations? Let's start with that question. Do you think? Absolutely. What is the biggest organization where we've learned that? What youth-serving organization is the biggest organization we've learned that?
Boy Scouts.
The Boy Scouts of America. That is absolutely right. One of the biggest youth-serving organizations where we have seen many and are still seeing, are we not, the special private files that have just been released of individuals who they knew for a fact were individuals that they couldn't allow or didn't want to let be scoutmasters anymore in other scout troops. We'll talk about that a little bit more. But what are some of the places where sex tourists would come in order to access children? Well, one of the places that children, that sex tourists come are to children's theme parks, Disney World, other types of theme parks that are around where you will find children, and where networking online by the parents or caregivers of those children allows the exchange of those children with an individual. We had a very high profile case in North Carolina of an offender, an IT guy, who had first been collecting child pornography for a while and then decided he wanted to become a producer. So he was online talking to other people about accessibility of children that could be available to him to become a producer of child pornography, meaning that he just wanted to sexually abuse them. As he was talking online, a guy from the UK said to him, "You know, I just wish I could be like you. It looks like you've been able to sexually abuse a bunch of kids, and I just wish I could be like you." So they dialogued for a while, and it was in a chat room which was entitled "For People with Fantasies of Incest." That was the name of the chat room. And another person came into the conversation, a mother from Dallas, Texas, who said, "Well, you know, I have some young children, so if you're really interested in this, you know, then we can work out a deal. Trust me, I have no need to make this up. Trust me." So, first, my offender in North Carolina groomed and mentored the UK guy who flew to the United States, met him. He made other victims available to this guy, and they ultimately went to Dallas, Texas, and sexually abused this woman's children for money. Now, out of all the different types of child sexual exploitation that I've been talking to you about so far, tell me which ones have happened in this one case. Remember, child pornography, intramural prostitution, cyber enticement, sex tourism, CSEC, and DMST. Those are the five types we've been talking about. Which ones? Note the word S. You're exactly right. There's child pornography production, intrafamilial prostitution by the mother in Dallas, Texas. We have cyber enticement, where the offender is talking to the mentee that's going to come over and sexually abuse children. We also, and in fact, the mother who's talking to them about making her children available is also participating in an enticement model. Sex tourism occurs when the UK guy comes to the United States, and then there is sexual abuse of these children for money. So even though we would want to say, you have got to be kidding, you know, even though we would want to say this cannot be true, because when I walked in the room, I saw such a nice carpet, and I didn't see a big pile of sand that we could stick our heads into. The point is that unless you recognize child abuse, you will not be able to prevent it. If you don't recognize the risks and what can happen,